We are back. You're watching ANC Presents COVID-19 in Numbers. Let's discuss the need for a multi-layered approach in fighting COVID-19. What does that exactly mean? We're still joined by Edson Guido, the head of ABS-CBN News' data analytics team. Now, we've basically laid the foundation right there that we are in a battle in multiple fronts, Edson. And because that is that, should we stick to a one-dimensional approach, or is a multi-dimensional, multi-layered approach now needed in this part of our battle in this pandemic? Edson.
So now we're facing Delta, and Delta's R-naught is equal to 8, or that means that one person with Delta can infect possibly 8 more people. So if we translate that to vaccination numbers, then at least 87.5% of the population should be vaccinated. And that's assuming that vaccines are 100% effective, which is not the case. So what we're seeing is that Delta really changed the game, and vaccination alone would no longer be enough to achieve herd immunity. And because of this, the Swiss cheese model is the way to go. So it's not really about a single layer of intervention, but rather the additive effect of multiple interventions, which can prevent the spread of the virus. So we have to continue to invest in testing, in tracing, in isolation, and we can't really solely rely on vaccines now to fight Delta. And everyone needs to continue to observe minimum health protocols, even the fully vaccinated. For the malls and restaurants, they must also review airflow and upgrade their ventilation systems, because that's also very important, because ventilation is not really discussed as much. So again, we need a multi-layered approach to prevent the spread of the virus moving forward.
Now, you just made a very interesting point there, Edson, because if we were to welcome back all these employees who have been working from home all this time, we ought to make sure that the infrastructure there is ready to welcome them back.
Yes, that is correct. For workplaces and even for restaurants and malls, even though we are going to welcome back the fully vaccinated, we've seen global examples of vaccinations not being enough to stop the spread of the virus. We also have to look at other aspects like ventilation in this case.
So when you go back to Delta, though, how did it complicate things even more than when we were dealing with a lesser virulent viruses, or at least mutations?
So it's really the transmissibility of Delta that is really causing problems, because if one person infected with Delta can infect 8 more people, then that would definitely have an impact in the transmission of the virus, which would make it more contagious, and that would also have an impact in the reproduction number. So with Deltas being more transmissible, that would definitely change the mathematical equation when it comes to the computation of concepts like herd immunity.
But when you talk about that, though, you talk about ventilation, you talk about, you know, other support layers, that doesn't negate at all the importance of vaccines. That still has to be the foundation in this battle.
Yes, that is correct. Because breakthrough infections, they happen, yes, because no vaccine is 100% effective. But the most important thing that we have to remember is that vaccines, they remain highly effective in preventing severe disease, hospitalization, and death. And we see this in global data, where cases, they rose in the US, in the UK, and Israel, but that did not necessarily translate to significantly higher deaths. And we observe that even if deaths in those countries have increased, they have not risen to 2020 or early 2021 levels, especially for the United Kingdom. So we really need to get vaccinated, because real-world evidence shows that vaccines work and vaccines save lives.
Now, Edson, at this point, we're going to bring in another voice into our discussion. Let's listen to the thoughts of Dr. Esperanza Cabral. She is, of course, a former secretary of the Health Department.
Not any one kind of approach is going to do the job for us. So we need the vaccines, but we also need to follow the minimum health protocols that are being advised by government. That's the two most important things. But aside from that, government has to be able to improve its ability to test, to contact trace, to provide for isolation and quarantine facilities, and very importantly, to make sure that the hospitals are equipped with tools as well as the medicines that they need to take care of people and to make sure that the healthcare workers are protected.
Edson, you know, Dr. Cabral there made a very important point about hospitals and healthcare workers that moment when she mentioned those, that this shouldn't be about infrastructure alone. I mean, we talk about bed occupancy and all of the announcements coming from the health department, also the capacity of critical care capacity of various hospitals. But it shouldn't be just about that. It should also be about manpower. Talk to us about that.
Yes, I agree. There should be investments definitely in healthcare capacity, in improving in increasing the number of ICU beds. But it should not just be about beds, but also in manpower and coordination for a more efficient referral system. So it's not just about the infrastructure in general, but also in investments in the number of people and also in training, so that we'd have more people who are able to treat patients, and that would help in not really overwhelming the health system in times of surges in the number of cases.
All right, and from there, we're gonna take a quick break. Coming up, where do we go from here? This is ANC Presents, COVID-19 in Numbers.